A ship would never leave a harbor if it did not have a destination. If you were to climb to the navigation bridge and ask the captain the name and location of his next port of call, he would tell you immediately. There's not the slightest doubt in his mind. Can you tell anyone your destination just as quickly and in one sentence? The captain of the ship knows that he can arrive at only one port at a time. He knows that it's impossible to arrive at two. Do you know that? He also knows that his destination will be invisible for fully 99% of his voyage, but he knows it's there and that he'll reach it if he will just keep doing certain things a certain way every day. One fine morning, his destination will appear on the horizon. He'll sail into port, his voyage successfully completed. When his business has been accomplished, he'll then sail to another predetermined port of call, and this will take him and his ship from one success to another for the rest of both of their lives. By understanding that he can reach only one port at a time, the owner of a ship can, in the short space of a very few years, reach hundreds of ports successfully. There'll be problems, lots of them, but they'll be solved, and the ship will steam its solitary course over the deep oceans of the world, devoting its life to accomplishing its mission. Men and women who follow this sensible, obvious, and meaningful way of life will do the same. But the paradox is that most are like ships without rudders. They're subject to the whims of wind and tide. And while they hope they'll one day arrive in a rich and bustling port, you and I know that for every narrow harbor entrance, there's 1,000 miles of treacherous and rocky coastline. The chances of their just drifting into port are 1,000 to 1 against them. These are the unfortunate people who, not knowing the rules, believe that circumstance controls our lives. They believe in luck and superstition, fate. They believe that success comes as the result of who you know, not what you know. And while they cling to their false alibis, life passes them by. For the rules of life are just, and they are checkmated, without haste, but without remorse. Now, what about you? Remembering that the definition of success is the progressive realization of a worthy ideal, what's the ideal toward which you are working now, today, yesterday, and tomorrow? Can you write it in one sentence? Is your goal sharply and clearly defined? If you can tell me what you want, I can tell you how to get it. You see, the trick is not in achieving our goals, it is in establishing them. You are at this moment the sum total of your thoughts to this point, for there is nothing else you can be. Succeeding in life has always been a matter of doing that which the great majority does not do. That's just the way it is, and if we don't recognize it, it will be to our cost. To amount to anything as individuals, we've got to be individuals. We've got to have individual goals, individual thinking, individual action. We must never conform to the great mass of people. We must love them, help them, for our joy and success will be determined by the extent to which we serve them. But we must never lose our individuality and identity by permitting ourselves to be submerged in this suffocating sea of indirection and purposelessness. There's nothing wrong with emulation. In fact, it's a good idea. So long as we emulate a person who represents that which we wish to become, but never the crowd, never the 95%. Do you know what the answer was, the secret to achievement that I had devoted nearly 20 years to finding? Its pure simplicity had caused it to elude me. I had been looking for something complicated, something only a mind prepared by years of study could grasp, and I found the answer so simple a child can understand it. In 6 words, we are what we think about. Our minds, our thinking, controls our destinies here on Earth to a degree totally unsuspected by the great majority of people. If we become what we think about, and if we can control our minds, we can pretty well tell our own future. And that's the point I want to make. Each one of us is the architect of the structure fashioned by our years. This means that if we're confused about what we wish to become or accomplish, our lives, our environment, will mirror that confusion. It also means that if we know what it is we seek, that it will, it must be accomplished. We as individuals can call our own shots for the rest of our lives. We can know what it means to go through life from one success to another, to play life according to the rules and reap the rewards. We can know what it means to have peace of mind and live calm, cheerful, successful lives. Successful living is nothing more than the ability to solve successfully the problems which are as much a part of living as breathing. The degree of our success will be determined by the extent to which we can solve our problems. The problem with the great majority of individuals is not with their ability to achieve their goals in life, but rather with the failure to understand two factors vital to successful living. The first is to make the decision as to what it is we want enough to give it most of our attention until it's been achieved, and to clearly define it. And the second is to fully understand that we have the ability to achieve this goal, or we wouldn't want it in the first place. The next vital rule to successful living is to understand that our success is won or lost by our ability to serve others. We are interdependent, and it's just as impossible to succeed without serving others as it would be to live in our modern world without others serving us. Our rewards in life will and must always be in exact proportion to our service. A lot of people don't like this law, if they're even aware of it, but not liking a law does nothing to change it. Look where you will find this law in undeviating operation. Our rewards will always be in exact proportion to our service. All attempts to sidestep or in any way avoid this law will result in frustration and failure. 95% of the people never quite understand, emotionally or intellectually, that we as individuals control, to an altogether unsuspected extent, our lives here on Earth. That each one of us is the architect of the structure fashioned by our years. All of us want the same things, but only about 5% figures out how to get them. The failure of most people to live successfully is not caused by their lack of abilities, far from it, but rather in their failure to decide what it is they want, and understanding that our wants are governed by our talents and abilities, and that we are divided into two groups of roughly 5% and 95%, and that it's the 5% group which is successful. Success is the progressive realization of a worthy ideal. That is, anyone who knows where he is going in life is a success. At the moment he makes the decision of what it is he intends to accomplish, of what it is he considers a worthy ideal, he is successful. Once this goal has been accomplished, he is again, by our definition, a failure, until he establishes a new goal toward which to work. To my mind, this is what we as human beings were intended to do, to go through life from one achievement to another, and to finally come to the end of our road here on Earth, still reaching, still working toward a new and better plateau on which to stand. For this is to live and live completely, to know as much as we can know, to serve as much as we can serve, to accomplish as much as we can accomplish. Since success is the progressive realization of a worthy ideal, why are we faced with only 5% who can be called really successful? Because the best estimates available tell us that only about 5% will ever decide upon and define the one thing they want. One thing, because we can only do one thing at a time. To my mind, the story of a person's life is the story of a quest, a search to which he devotes his life. We know that the happiest people on earth are those who know exactly what it is they seek and set boldly out to find it. And while we're all dreamers, the fortunate ones are those who have found a dream so exciting and worthwhile that they'll devote a part or all of their lives to making that dream come true. But while all dream, by far the great majority, that 95%, never realizes that a persistent daydream is often the point on which we should set our compass, the place toward which it is meant for us to journey. The tragedy is that the great majority shrugs off this built-in direction finder and returns to the wide, visible, well-marked road in life which they feel must be the best road because it carries the heaviest traffic. Well, let's make this point clear. The road in life with the heaviest traffic is not the best road to follow, for it is the road of the 95%. It is the road with no more opportunity. Discouragement can only come from one of two things. One, a lack of information, or two, a situation over which we can exercise no control. It is very seldom that we're faced with number two. Almost all discouragement can be traced to a lack of information. If you find yourself falling from the top of a high building, you could justify discouragement, but it can be traced to your having made the fatal step and that was a lack of information about the law of gravity. You need only take a look at human history. Of all the billions of human beings who've lived on Earth, all great advances, all great ideas have come from just a handful, a few thousand out of billions. Now, how have the people as a group reacted to the great ideas? Every great leader and thinker, from Socrates to the Wright brothers, has been scorned, ridiculed, poisoned, imprisoned, stoned, burned at the stake, or crucified. Why? Lack of information. Lack of knowledge. It comes from following the wrong crowd. Every job, no matter what it may be, holds somewhere within itself the key to everything we want in life, the key to greatness. But we must look for it, and we must think. It is being undecided, uncommitted about what we're going to do that keeps us from doing our best. We're working with one hand and looking around with the other. So make the decision once and for all. Perhaps for the first time in your life, you will know where you are in the world. We can either compete or create. And when we begin to do this, there's no limit to that which we can achieve. Most people will tell you that security rests with a job. This is impossible. There is no such thing as a job that represents security. Anyone with a job can lose it for any one of a thousand reasons at any time. A job cannot represent security. There is only one place on earth you can find security. And if it isn't there, it isn't anywhere. It's inside of a person, never outside. If a man has security inside, where it belongs, his wife and children can feel it when he sits down to eat with them, and they're warmed by it. If a man has security inside, where it belongs, you can see it walking down the street, and you can feel it when he enters a room. That's security, and you can't take it away from him. You can take away his money, his home, and drop him anywhere in the country. Go back in a year, and he'll be doing just as well as when you found him the first time. You can't keep a good man down, no matter what you do to him. This man or this woman has security, where it belongs. It comes from being a pro in a world of amateurs. Becoming a pro isn't difficult. It comes from knowing what to do with time. It comes from knowledge, planning, and working. And by devoting an hour a day to study, we can become outstanding professionals in 5 years or less. The person who does this is the person people call lucky. Good things just seem to happen to him. The so-called breaks start coming his way. But it's a result of planning and working positively that attracts the good things to us. I can't emphasize too much the importance of describing your goal in detail. You're on course, and you reach more successful ports in a few years than most men do in a lifetime. Working more than the average, if we're going to achieve more than average results, is necessary, of course. But with proper planning and with knowledge, it seems easy. Unless we have a desire to do a certain thing, we find ourselves without the energy. But you will never find desire without energy. Once our goal has been crystallized in our minds and we realize that we become what we think about, our doubts vanish as to whether or not we can achieve our desired end. And with the picture of our dream in our mind, we have abundant energy. Compared with what we ought to be, we're only half awake. Our fires are damped. Our drafts are checked. We're making use of only a small part of our possible mental and physical resources. Stating the thing broadly, the human individual thus lives usually far within his limits. He possesses powers of various sorts which he habitually fails to use. He energizes below his maximum, and he behaves below his optimum. By pushing past the first false feeling of fatigue, we will find an exhilarating second wind that will take us to our goals. Start acting the part of the person you wish to become. Carry, as often as you can, a clear mental image of the person you want to be, and begin to be that person. It will lead you without fail to the goal you seek. You see, when you begin to do this, you're using your greatest power, your mind, and you will become what you think about. The only thing about a man that is a man is his mind. Everything else you can find in a pig or a horse. Our minds represent our hope and our future. Yet, as a rule, it is the last place the average person will turn to for help. Your mind contains riches beyond belief, but you must prospect this rich and largely unexplored continent. And the only way it can be prospected is by systematic study and systematic thinking. Your mind is like a muscle. It will develop only to the extent that you use it, no more. You're building your mind into a powerful and creative servant. The first and most important thing to remember is the rule that controls our life. We become literally what we think about. We must fully understand, emotionally as well as intellectually, that whatever it is we set our heart upon will become real in our lives. We must realize, too, that security can be found in one place only, inside of us. If it isn't there, it isn't anywhere. Let's be different. A strong life is like that of a ship of war, which has its own place in the fleet and can share in its strength and discipline, but can also go forth alone to the solitude of the infinite sea.
Reject stagnation. Reject the myth that learning is for young people. It's what you learn after you know it all that counts. Learn all your life, from your successes, from your failures. Bad times have a scientific value. These are occasions a good learner wouldn't miss. What is it trying to teach me? Individuals who remain vital have learned not to be imprisoned by fixed habits, attitudes, and routines. We build our own prisons and serve as our own jailers. But if we build the prisons ourselves, we can tear them down ourselves. If we're willing to learn, the opportunities are everywhere. We learn from our work and from our friends and families. We learn by accepting the obligations of life, by suffering, by taking risks, by loving, by bearing life's indignities with dignity. You learn to bear with the things you can't change. You learn to avoid self-pity. You learn not to burn up energy and anxiety. You learn that most people are neither for you nor against you, but rather are thinking about themselves. You learn that no matter how much you try to please, some people are never going to love you, a notion that troubles at first, but is eventually relaxing. Among your obligations is an appointment with yourself. One of the most valuable things you learn is that ultimately you're the one who's responsible for you. You don't blame others, you don't blame circumstances, you take charge. If you're going to keep on learning, your surest allies will be high motivation and enthusiasm. People can achieve meaning only if they've made a commitment to something larger than their own little egos, whether to loved ones, to fellow humans, to work, or to some moral or religious concept. Confidence is built upon an experience of success. When we first begin any undertaking, we're likely to have very little confidence, because we haven't learned from experience that we can succeed. We need to form the habit of remembering past successes and forgetting the failures. This is the way both an electronic computer and the human brain are supposed to operate. Practice improves skill and success. There is a time in every man's education when he arrives at the conviction that envy is ignorance, that imitation is suicide, and that though the wide universe is full of good, no kernel of nourishing corn can come to him but through the toil bestowed on that plot of ground which is given him to till. The power which resides in him is new in nature, and none but he knows what that is which he can do, nor does he know until he's tried. trust thyself. Every heart vibrates to that iron string. No one can even estimate the number of people who live nervous, anxious, unhappy lives because they daily attempt the impossible, which is to be like someone else. There are people who don't realize the truth of Emerson's words, that envy is ignorance, that imitation is suicide. He must have used the word suicide because we have to kill that which is natural in ourselves when we attempt to be like someone else. They need to recognize the truth also, that the power that resides in them is new in nature, that it has never appeared before in just that way on earth, that if they'll learn about and develop their own powers, they'll have no need of envy or imitation. Envy is ignorance because it means a person is ignorant of his own powers and abilities, his one-of-a-kind natural talent. He's never looked within himself for his own road to greatness, but instead seeks it in the lives of others. And when he fails to succeed, as do those he envies, as fail he must because he can't possibly be exactly like them, his image of himself shrinks. Not understanding that he is unlike those he envies, he doesn't realize that this simple fact lies at the bottom of his failure. Nor does he understand that he can be as successful as anyone on earth if he will build upon that power that resides in him. As Emerson put it, the power which resides in him is new in nature, and none but he knows what that is which he can do, nor does he know until he's tried. This is why a parent is off base when he says to a child, "Why aren't you like so-and-so, like a brother or some model child? Look what he's doing." The parent doesn't understand that it's a human impossibility for the child to be like so-and-so and to do what he does in the same way. Instead, a parent would be wise to say, "Don't worry about so-and-so. He's found his strength, and he's building on it. You have a strength of your own, and when you find it, you can build just as high." Trust thyself. Every heart vibrates to that iron string. When a person finds himself, when he stops imitating and envying others, there's something in his nature that says to him, "This is it. You've found your road at last." Real success is a matter of finding yourself and building upon what you find, just as of those whom so many envy. Every person is born to be a star at something. The purpose of his or her life is to discover it, and then to spend his or her years building upon that plot of ground it was given to him and to her to till. With such an abundance of everything, we're often like children standing in front of a mile-long candy counter or a person looking at a really good restaurant menu. How do you make a selection from such abundance? If you decide on one thing, you're passing up all those other things. As a result, many people choose impulsively. Often, too, by getting too many little things, they dissipate their means, and thus they're unable to obtain larger, more important things. So it's wise to spend some time thinking about just exactly what we will want from the years ahead of us. What will comfort and enrich us on snowy or rainy days? What will cause us to get up in the morning with interest and enthusiasm in our later years? And to what do we wish to commit ourselves for at least a part of our days that's big enough and interesting enough to keep us happily occupied for the rest of our lives? A person who lacks confidence in himself is a person who has never really tested his powers. A test to be valid must include a whole lot more than one or two tries. Imagination is everything. That's everything, not to be confused with some things. Imagination is everything. I remember reading in the book Papillon, that incredible tale of multiple escapes from the French penal colony in French Guiana, that no matter what the hardships were, or how wretched the escapees' lives, they were filled with joy as long as they were moving toward freedom. Pain, suffering, starvation, exhaustion, constant danger were all worth bearing as long as they were moving toward freedom. This is why we need to reaffirm our goals on a regular basis, why we need to make sure we know what it is we're moving toward. It's when things go hardest, when life becomes most trying, that there's greatest need for having a fixed goal, for having an air castle that the outside world cannot wreck.
The Force exists, and it has a scientific basis. But what does that power consist of? If we can define and isolate such a force, how can you or I tap into it? Through vision, commitment, patience, and creative application of knowledge and skill, you can see your goal through to the end. But the ultimate key to your success is persistence and perseverance. You'll find out how to turn problems and setbacks, even agonizing situations, into positive learning experiences that will actually bring you closer to the realization of your goal. And you'll understand the value of never giving up, no matter how tough the journey gets or how endless it seems. Persistence means never giving up. Perseverance means persisting in spite of hardships, opposition, and setbacks. Self-discipline is the power to say, this is what I really want in life, and this is how I'm going to get it. And if I have to give up some other things, I will, because it's worth it in the long run. To be self-disciplined, you must learn to develop the kind of obsession that glows like a beacon in a storm. You must learn to watch that light and steer your course towards it, no matter what gets in your way or how long it takes. Like a sailor, you must learn to use the skills that will point you in the right direction. And you must keep on using all your knowledge, skill, and energy to stay on course until you have reached your destination. With a steady, sustained effort that never falters, never crumbles, and never gets lost in unimportant details, you can be anything you want. Success consists of self-discipline. And self-discipline consists of doing whatever you have to do for as long as you have to do it to get where you want to be. If you truly want to seek your fortune, you must develop the inner strength to relentlessly pursue your vision day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, until it becomes a reality. And it will become a reality. Just think, how long did it take you to learn how to walk? For how many weeks and months did you struggle to stand upright? How many bruises did you get from falling down? And how many times did you pick yourself up and try again? You learned to walk because as a toddler, you became obsessed with learning to walk. You were determined to learn, no matter how hard it was at first or how long it was going to take. Every step you took was a small victory, and every time you fell down, it was just an excuse to start all over. Children are naturally self-disciplined because children believe that everything is possible. Children don't say, I can't do it. Children say, I want to do it. When you want something badly enough, and when you believe in it strongly enough, self-discipline will get it for you. Self-discipline is the most powerful tool you own for bridging the gap between wishful thinking and real fulfillment. You can have those good things by developing the self-discipline to achieve them. Einstein said, "The more I learn, the more I realize I don't know. The more I realize I don't know, the more I want to learn." If you have the self-discipline to see your efforts through, you can learn anything at any age. Whatever you have to learn, no matter how abstract or detailed the information, if it's necessary for your vision, then you can embody that information with your vision. Then it becomes something real and vital, You can put a handle on it. You have a reference for it. Learning is a lot easier if you have a specific reason to learn. Once you recognize that you have a need to learn, you've taken the first step toward achieving your goal. Creativity is the byproduct of a disciplined, well-informed mind. A mind that is using its storehouse of knowledge to solve problems and achieve goals. The more you learn, the more creative you can become. The belief in yourself as someone who is capable of learning is 90% of the learning hurdle. The other 10% is single-minded application mixed with ability. Much of your own belief in yourself as someone who is capable of learning complex material may have been educated right out of you in school. Take math, for example. Many people have learning blocks when it comes to math. They feel that they just don't have the aptitude to learn complex mathematical concepts. What most of these people lack is not the aptitude for math, but the application of self-discipline. Math requires progressive learning. You have to master one concept before you can go on to the next. If you miss a few steps in between, then it's really easy to get lost. And once you get lost, it's nearly impossible to catch up. To stay on top in math requires a daily effort of study. Most people who enter math think that they can get by with a minimum of effort. Most of these people are intelligent. They can get by in most other courses by just coasting. They think they can do the same thing in math. But soon they get behind and can't catch up and usually do poorly in the course. After such an experience, they label themselves as poor in math. They carry this label with them throughout their lives. Actually, they probably had and have the aptitude, but not the attitude. Their life's potential was stunted by a false assumption. Breaking the cycle of a negative attitude may not be easy, but once you do, you'll be far less inclined to get back into the cycle. That's why small steps and small accomplishments are so important in pursuing a macro goal. Once you have successfully learned a subject or skill, it bolsters your confidence in your ability to learn other skills. Once you've proven to yourself that a negative concept you had was wrong, you begin to realize that all of your negative concepts may be wrong. What you couldn't do in the past, you can now do. You can do it because finally you believe you can do it. Your past, in which you may have been labeled or labeled yourself as a non-learner, is precisely that, your past. It is not your present. It has little relation to what you are capable of accomplishing now. What has happened to many of us is that we have been conditioned into a negative feedback loop where learning is concerned. The step-by-step accumulation of new skills is the way to break this loop and replace it with a much more positive cycle. Most of us, at the time we are exposed to our greatest concentration of education, haven't developed the necessary self-discipline skills to be able to take advantage of it. All requires seasoning, the accumulation of knowledge over time, the perseverance to stick with a task over a long period of time, sometimes decades, the ability to find pleasure in the accomplishment of steps toward a goal, rather than seeking the instantly gratifying quick fix. All these are the hallmarks of the self-discipline. What do you want that you're willing to pay the price for? What means so much to you that you'll spend weeks, months, or years pursuing it? Start thinking about your most cherished dream. Because with the power of self-discipline, you're finally going to be able to achieve it. You'll learn how to gain the knowledge and skills that will set you on the path to success. And you'll learn to develop the kind of positive strength it takes to stay on that path until you have reached the very end. Once you get a taste of how intoxicating, of how free self-discipline feels, you'll be hooked on it for life. Behind every great achiever, there's another achiever. It may be someone close to home, a parent, teacher, or friend. It may be someone who's currently famous, or it may be a historical or mythological figure. When you get your shot of motivation, you become enthusiastic and energetic. When the shot wears off, you get sluggish and lethargic. The truth is, to be truly effective in the long term, motivation must come from within. I'd like to point out that acquiring self-discipline is a never-ending process. There won't come a day when you wake up in the morning and say, "Yes, I'm finally self-disciplined now. There's nothing more I need to do to develop strength of character and determination of will." Self-discipline requires a lifetime of commitment. This doesn't mean you won't develop the habits of self-discipline in a relatively short period of time. It simply means that you must always be vigilant about how you are approaching your goals and what your purpose in life really is. It's all too easy to get sidetracked in something that feels comfortable but is not what you really set out to achieve. Every small victory will become a cause for celebration and a chance to renew your faith in your own ability to achieve whatever it is you want in life. And as you achieve it, you will find yourself becoming the kind of person you've always admired. The kind of person who could pursue a goal so single-mindedly, so stubbornly, and so patiently that he or she could not help but achieve it. It would be nice if we were all born with the patience, drive, and skill it takes to achieve any long-range goal or complete any long-term project, but we're not. Self-discipline is a learned behavior. What do you value above all else? What would you like to be remembered for? One other myth about the acquisition of knowledge has it that you can get too old to learn. This bit of fallacious thinking has been handed down in the aphorism that you can't teach old dogs new tricks. It's worth laying to rest. To keep young, one must keep growing.
So you can read the stars. Are they always right?
Usually. Some nights it can be difficult to interpret them.
There are five crucial steps involved in learning how to develop into the kind of self-disciplined achiever who never quits and never loses sight of his or her goal. The first step is to rekindle and refuel your vision and purpose every single day. Remind yourself daily of the rewards and benefits that await you when you successfully realize your goal. The emotion you draw from these constant reminders of why you're working so hard and giving up so many things will sustain your powers of persistence and perseverance. The second step is to firmly anchor the following attitude deep within your heart and mind. I can achieve anything I set my mind to. Nothing is impossible for me to achieve if I want it badly enough and am willing to pay the price for it. No matter how much hard work it takes, no matter how long it takes, no matter how difficult it is, I can and will achieve my goal. Step 3. Realize that obstacles are going to arise and setbacks are going to occur. Keep in mind that these difficulties are really opportunities to learn. Every obstacle that you overcome, every setback you bounce back from, strengthens your character and makes you smarter and stronger. Whatever you do, don't try to hide from or ignore problems. They never go away by themselves. Meeting challenges squarely and solving problems creatively is at the heart of self-discipline and at the heart of achievement. Those things that hurt instruct. When your progress seems blocked, it means that it's time to increase your knowledge and look for creative solutions. This is the fourth step in developing persistence and perseverance. You may be doing the wrong things for the right reasons, and now is the time to find out. Start experimenting with taking different paths to your destination. But whatever you do, don't quit. Most people quit when things don't work out as they planned, or when they realize how much hard work they're going to have to do. Remember, a failure is someone who has not learned from his mistakes. Step 5. Turn your work into fun. Make what you have to do into something you want to do. Working towards a lifelong goal shouldn't feel like a sacrifice, because that goal is what you want more than anything in the world. Your long road to success will turn into an exciting journey of knowledge, discovery, challenge, and reward. The real problem arises when a major setback occurs, especially if it's unforeseen. A seemingly insurmountable obstacle is often enough to make even the most determined achiever decide that the fight simply isn't worth it. Setbacks make people give up just at the point when they should not. How can you deal successfully with setbacks? How can you learn not to feel like a failure when it suddenly seems that all of your hard work may have been for nothing? There are 5 ways you can turn every setback you encounter into a learning experience. First, never try to ignore a problem or handicap. Deal with your problems directly. Don't avoid them or try to hide from them. When you have a problem, study it from all angles and try to determine the best way to proceed. Which brings us to our second point. Don't blame other people for your setbacks, and don't chalk it up to bad luck. You make your own luck in this life, and you have to solve your own problems. Learn to tackle them head on, being as realistic as possible and as level-headed as possible. Third, continually strive to strengthen your qualities of self-discipline. Setbacks often occur because of weaknesses in certain areas. Try to turn those weaknesses into strengths. Be your own severest critic, but not your own worst enemy. Don't tell yourself, "I failed." Tell yourself, "I slipped, but I'm going to pick myself up and go on." Fourth, in almost every setback, there's a seed of opportunity, a silver lining, if you will. Find it and use it. You may find yourself taking a slightly different path to achieving your goal than you first imagined, but you'll get there just the same. Take the new path and see where it leads you. Following this philosophy helps take the emotional sting out of setbacks and is a good antidote for discouragement. And it's a healthier way to react to a bad situation than deciding to give up. Fifth, always remember that no matter how difficult a problem is or how insurmountable it seems, there's always a solution. A problem is only really a problem if you think you can't solve it. If you take the attitude that every problem has a solution, and you approach your problem with an open and creative mind, you'll find that solution. The key to reaching any goal is to develop the strength of character that makes you refuse to give up, no matter how bad things look. The most amazing thing about persistence and perseverance is that they make it almost impossible for you not to succeed in your endeavors. In the years to come, you'll find yourself learning from trial and error, from accomplishments, from setbacks, from disappointments, from rewards, from the feeling of satisfaction you get when a job has been well done. The more you achieve, the more you'll learn one of the greatest secrets of achievement. Success breeds success. Every small step you take on the road to your goal will make it easier to take the next step. And once you've achieved your goal, you'll probably find that there's another goal you want to achieve. Along the way, you'll delight in the process of watching yourself in action, making corrections in your methods and strategies as you strive toward your ultimate goal and the hundreds of smaller goals you will successfully reach on the way. you uncovered the master key to your highest potential, self-discipline. We define self-discipline as the ability to work systematically and progressively toward a goal. To become positively obsessed with that goal, and to let that obsession lead you to accomplishment. There is no other way to be successful except through hard work. The words pay for shouldn't bother you. All accomplishments come with a price tag, just like something you might want to buy. You should also be willing to make sacrifices in order to reach your goal. You may have to give up time, recreational activities, other priorities in your life. But it won't be difficult to do, because reaching your goal will become a more important source of pleasure. Self-disciplined achievers have a strong sense of purpose. They have a cause or direction to which they have chosen to dedicate their lives. This cause gives them meaning in their lives and a reason to exist. Those possessing an iron will dwell on the fulfillment of their vision rather than on fear and failure. They have a positive attitude toward themselves and their goal and refuse to let setbacks get them down. The self-disciplined achiever has a deep-rooted belief in his or her ability to achieve. They know that a goal can never successfully be reached in a haphazard way. They understand that they must map out a blueprint for success if they are ever to realize their highest ambitions. People who achieve their goals do so through persistence and perseverance. They are stubborn in their efforts to achieve, and they never give up. Self-disciplined achievers have a mature attitude toward pleasure. Rather than seeking any diversion that will temporarily make them feel better, they take the most pleasure in doing the work that will help them achieve their goal. Truly self-disciplined people are not bored, unhappy, or suffering from any kind of deprivation. In fact, they have learned to give themselves the true joy that comes from pursuing and achieving their most cherished goals and dreams. Self-discipline is your ability to systematically and progressively work towards a goal until you have reached it. It's your ability to become positively obsessed, single-minded, and efficient, to strive without giving up, to work consistently day after day, week after week, and year after year until your purpose is fulfilled.
It's incredible that the light from those stars has taken millions of years to get here. How many lifetimes must it have taken for that light to reach the Earth?
More than we can imagine, but the Earth is only the start of its great journey.